Hello friends, and welcome to Levelhead, where we look at and learn from great level design. Today we're taking a look at the retro action platformer, Shovel Knight. Let's dig in.
Shovel puns aside, because let's be honest here, they've all been made already, Shovel Knight is fantastic. The first thing many people will tell you is that it obviously takes heavy inspiration from NES hits like Mega Man, Zelda 2, Castlevania, etc. But Shovel Knight doesn't just borrow ideas, it refines them. The concepts and inspiration of this game aren't just skin deep. Within minutes of starting my first playthrough, I knew Shovel Knight needed a level head. But then I was met with the biggest problem I've ever faced while making this show. Which level to pick? Seriously, every single stage was a perfect candidate for an episode. After a few playthroughs though, it was clear that it had to be Propeller Knight's stage, the flying machine. I'm not one to talk about thematics much, mostly focusing on physical attributes of level design, but I just can't pass up the all-encompassing romantic atmosphere of the flying machine. The warm color palette, the adventurous and exotic music, and damn, just look at that sunset, look at it! You know that feeling when the song He's a Pirate is playing and Johnny Depp is sword fighting some guys and you're just like, yeah, adventure, this is awesome! This level is the embodiment of that. This episode will mark a sort of turning point, my fellow levelheads. Instead of breaking down every inch of the stage, I'm going to leave some of the broader details for you to discover. But I digress, let's jump into the level. There are three main vertical climbing segments of this level, and they all share the same ideas and philosophy, but before we get to that, let's look at each of them individually. The flying machine doesn't beat around the bush. The first screen sets the stage so well in such a minimalistic way. Ladder on the right, jellies floating in the way, what does this tell us? Well, let's see. The ladder going up makes this the first level that you start off by ascending. It tells you that this one is extremely vertically oriented. The jellies are obvious stepping stones to be bounced on, and putting it as the very first obstacle sets up the importance of knowing this mechanic inside and out. Alright, so the second screen sets up another big mechanic, falling platforms. You reach the top of the ladder and while it seems like there's no way to get here, there's nothing else for you to do aside from jump onto a platform. As soon as you touch it, it shakes and makes a sound and very smoothly begins to fall, giving you plenty of time to react and continue left. Naturally, while jumping from platform to platform, you end up here, almost purely by reaction, and this platform carries you down into position to reach the ladder. Now we start to speed things up. This is where we're gently introduced to wind and fans, a big mechanical part of the flying machine. The first fan is placed in a spot where you get a lot of room to float for a bit and safely get a feel for the control. These jellies have an invulnerability period where they deal contact damage, and since they make you wait while you're hovering near this oh-so-conspicuous vent in the wall, it's clearly set up to make you a little antsy while waiting and perhaps even accidentally hit this wall by spamming. It's a wonderful little aha moment. Oddly enough, you can't make it into this room just on the wind flow, so you'll actually have to, well, you know what, we'll get to that. Anyways, so you kill the jelly and move forward, and since you already know this is a falling platform, you avoid loitering for too long. And if you forgot, well, now you know. We'll go into some detail on this in just a second. The next jelly is a little trickier, but once destroyed, you're clear to land over here. As simple as can be, you break the dirt blocks and are taught that dirt stops wind flow. Did Satchbag design this part? Because damn, that was concise. Moving up, we learn even more. Note the position of the star enemy on screen, a little to the left of Shovel Knight, but also aiming left. He fires a green ball of energy and you're completely safe to watch it go and learn what it does. You're not in any danger yet, and you're already prepped to face the danger within seconds of seeing it. The other thing you're tipped off to are these foreground panels. There are bugs poking their heads out and chilling to give you an idea of how the panels work. And since there's a lot of ground space to work with, you can experiment to yourself for a little while. And if they trip you up and make you fall, we're getting there. Be patient. But let's keep going. There's still a lot of ground and air to cover. This moving platform gives you a taste of precision jumping while dodging or dealing with threats. It's easing you into the harder parts of the level without scaring you away. Let's jump forward. If you've been paying close attention throughout the rest of the level to the placement of secrets, you might notice how this checkpoint is a little off-center and be drawn to strike these details on the wall, revealing a full heal and some treasure. Onward and upward it is. Alright, so while the green Adventure Time Jawas you met earlier in the level are jerks, this blue one is actually rather friendly. If you take a moment to assess the situation, he'll pop up and give you a wind current to reach the right side of the screen and head upwards. As soon as you enter this screen, you can observe that the jellies have a set pattern of activating their electricity as a window of opportunity to bounce on them. It starts on the second jelly, making sure that you don't rush out on top of them and forcing you to wait for a bit. While sticking around, you may notice the pink diamond chilling behind this wall decoration, and now you know that this isn't a solid wall. Neat! We head on forward, bouncing in rhythm and ascending even further. Your only enemy here is far away, giving you a lot of time to take in the platform patterns before you attempt your journey. Since the caster makes it rather difficult to navigate, either out of frustration or necessity, you're drawn to take him down. Perhaps you'll overshoot your last swing, or maybe notice how odd it is that this enemy was stationed here with no roofing or overhead graphics. But back here is another secret, and this one leads to a dead end of sorts. Let's move on because we'll come back to this. Skipping ahead, you have some momentum, so you're going to be sprinting through this checkpoint and jumping on this airway. Just as you wonder how it could be safe to proceed, both vents shut off and you can head to the ladder safely. What would Propeller Knight stage be without propeller rats? They're pretty easily dispatched, but their purpose is to slow you down. The wall of spikes, the moving fans, everything on the screen is calming you down and toning back the tempo to get you focused. We'll talk about this pink diamond in just a second, but when you top the ladder, you're pushed just slightly over by the wind. It's just enough to let you know, hey buddy, the wind is kinda dangerous, but not enough to make you fall unfairly. If you wait a moment, like you were taught just two screens ago, the fans die down and you're clear to move on. Now, this room is really tricky. There's a downward pointing fan, meaning you can't be in open space with it above you or you get bopped down into the pit. And then there's this knight dude, and heck, I would be shocked if you didn't fall down the first time you got here. I've kept you waiting long enough. The reason I love this level is so very incredibly simple, yet genius. With all these interesting single-screen obstacle courses in the vertical segments, they managed to make failing each one only ever take you back one single screen. Check this out. On the first screen where you're shown these falling platforms, all of the gaps drop you down onto these closely spaced jellies. The screen transition is slow and holds you in place, giving you a few seconds to set up a downstab and smoothly climb back onto the ladder. And don't you feel like a badass doing it? You should, because you are. Like right here. These blue jellies have plenty of potential to knock you around, but both of the gaps you can fall in are oriented so that if you're holding either direction, you'll land on a platform below and be already in position to make your way back up and try again. And right here, this bug can knock you back into the pit, but you either land on the pillar with ease or fall a screen further and land directly onto a falling platform. With this moving platform and the mage's blast, you're bound to drop off at least once, but even then you're given a path to the secret you opened up earlier. It's so damn smart! And here, you may attempt to attack this blue Jawa dude, and if you linger, he'll let you drop, but you'll already be nicely aligned to catch this cannonball back up to the ladder. And this screen, if you drop off the ladder, and especially after you've gotten this diamond, it helps you realize that a big drop like that can allow you to go through these wind currents and enter a secret area, where you end up getting the relic for this level. Remember that the jellies always start their cycle on this raised up one right here to stop you from diving into this part blindly? They're also, more importantly, aligned in a way where if you fall from the screen above, you will almost always be landing on this jelly, which sends you forward into recovery. Do you see this? You'll almost never be falling off of the easy platform right here, and there's plenty of space on both sides to keep from falling down a screen. But here? Mage blasts, fans, side-to-side platform, dirt in the way, this is what's gonna trip you up, and they know it! The devs have your back! Dang! This one looks insanely dangerous, right? But really, you should almost never hit these spikes unless you're trying to flex at the fan. The screen above has a rat blocking that area, and the fan is moving towards you. If you fall, there's a good chance it'll be far enough to the right to be perfectly safe and ready to try again. And then up here, you're tempted by pink diamonds, and if you go for them and get blown away, you're gonna be laying into left on your D-pad, and you have just enough room to catch the ladder again if you are. And if you aren't, you land on this huge safe zone. And all of these falling platforms, should they trip you up, drop you right onto the moving fans below. And check out this big block of solid ground. It hangs over the spike wall, so there's almost no way for you to get skewered while falling. When you reach the top, you have to fight the knight with this obnoxious downward-facing fan, right? He'll get aggroed as soon as you step on this falling block, limiting your movement options, but any place that you fall drops you into a great spot to get back up almost immediately. For real guys, you can fall off dozens of times and be completely fine, and it takes less than 3 seconds to get back up and start the fight again. On one hand, it's forgiving and allows you all of the room in the world for error, but on the other, it ensures that you can't even make one mistake if you want to beat this knight. You have to win the fight. You have to avoid falling. You have to play smart and strategic. Only the strong shall move forward. This is a massive hurdle, but the payoff is insanely satisfying. Every single gap and every open pit either falls directly onto or close enough to a platform of some sort, allowing you to regain your footing and jump right back into the action. This ain't no Metroid 1 jumping for 12 years and then falling accidentally all the gosh dang way down again design. This is good vertical level design. For real, a lot of people focus on how tough this game can be and how it pulls inspiration from brutal games like Dark Souls and Castlevania, but in reality, every level gives you a lot of room for trial and error without being too overbearing as far as difficulty goes. And it's not just a simple manner of putting platforms under the spots where you can fall. Everything is oriented in a way where each failure provides several options for recovery, and they're aligned to where you'll be reflexively hitting these recoveries as if it was second nature. Each and every screen takes into account the one below it. Falling behind only reinforces progress. Repetition is the mother of learning, as they say, and every repeated run through a screen has you learning more and more, and getting that much better at the game. You get knocked back? The devs know you're going to be holding this direction or that one, and they've already figured out the most likely reactions and giving them fulfilling, positive outcomes that make you feel not like you're being stomped on by the level, but like you're the intrepid Shovel Knight that can tackle any challenge. It's this kind of design that truly sets the great games apart from the good ones. While I chose the flying machine, every level in Shovel Knight incorporates its own unique design choices that provide wide diversity, and they all manage to invoke these same ideas. Shovel Knight is, without a doubt, the instant classic of our generation.
If you're looking to feel nostalgic without playing a decades-old game, and above all else, if you're looking to have fun, Shovel Knight quite easily gets my recommendation. At $15 on several platforms, it's a no-brainer.
Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this episode of Levelhead, why don't you check out another one? Oh, and don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe if you want to see more. This has been Sunder, and I'll see you next time.